I will now move on to the second speaker, who is Professor Teresa Lager from University of Porto and member of the European Research Council's Scientific Committee. And the title is Integrating Gender Equality Recommendations into Practices at the European Research Council. So please.
Well, I must confess that I have an unexpected challenge. I was expecting a monitor closer to me where I could read and control, so I have to go to the... It's on the back and here, but it's too far from my eyes, I think.
You want to borrow that?
No, I have glasses, but not that good. Okay, I will be talking about integrating gender equality recommendations into practices at the European Research Council. So let me introduce the ERC, European Research Council, is the organization that supports excellence in frontier research in Europe. And the strategy is to support the investigator-driven frontier research in all fields of knowledge, excellence being the only criteria, to attract and retain leading researchers from anywhere in the world, regardless of gender, nationality, and age, and on the condition that host organization is in Europe. We adopted global peer review. Our grants are portable, very attractive, and very flexible to be managed by the PIs. We also adopted a simplification and full transparency in the procedures, and we provide benchmarks and levers towards broader structural improvements in European research. Here is our budget for next year. We will have 1.7 billion euros. The ERC structure has three pillars: the European Commission that provides the financing, guarantees autonomy of the ERC, assures the integrity and accountability of the ERC, adopts the annual programs as established by the Scientific Council. The ERC Scientific Council, that's composed by 22 researchers, proposed by an independent identification committee appointed by the Commission for 4 years period, renewable only once. The Scientific Council is responsible for establishing the overall scientific strategy, the annual programs for the panels, for the calls for proposal, and so on, controls the quality of the operations and management, and ensures communication with the scientific community, since we are part of the scientific community. The third pillar is the European DRC executive agency that executes the annual work program as established by the Scientific Council, implements the calls for proposals, organizes peer review evaluation, establishes and manages grant agreements, administrative, scientific, and financial aspects, and carries out the communication, all the communication activities. To present you briefly our grant system, we have at the moment five types of grants, the so-called starting grants, that are for the early stages of the research careers for people between 2 and 7 years after the PhD. Consolidator grants that are for researchers between 7 and 12 years, and the advanced grants for the more senior researchers. All these grants are for 5 years, and they, as you can see, they have significant amounts of money, and all of them are quite free to manage. We fully trust the PI once the program has been selected. So they are very flexible to be managed by the PI. Then we have the Synergy Grants. It's an experiment that we start this year, where 2 to 4 PIs are involved in order to address very complex problems that need contributions from different fields of knowledge. And then we have the Proof of Concept that is a kind of bridge, is trying to bridge between the research, the results of research, and the early stages of marketable innovation. The ERC grants are very competitive. You probably cannot read, but on the left you will see the average research, the average success rate is 12%. On the left you see the success rate for the starting grants, the first five columns. On the right for the more senior grants, the advanced grants. And as you know, the evolution of success rate with the years, but anyways, always around 12% at most. Early signs of impact of the European Research Council. DRC is only 5 years old, but we already have various important signs of impact. Impact on researchers. Oops. Impact on researchers. Since more than 3,000 researchers have been helped by DRC to follow their curiosities, so to do their research programs. And many of these researchers are young researchers. You can see here the distribution on the left, on the orange color is for the starting grants. The blue color is the age distribution for the advanced grants. And you can see that we have grantees from 23 to 74 years old. And there are no distinct populations, they merge. And the number, as I mentioned, is now above 3,000. There are other signals of impact, and this is to do with the developing the new generation of excellent scientists. Here we show a study, a sample of VRC grantees, and we have analyzed the teams of the VRC grantees. And in average, each team, each PI has contracted 6 members for her or his team. And of course, the dimension of the teams is different, varies with the field. But globally, besides the 3,000 grantees, already more than 14,000 PhDs and postdocs are involved, are working in the ERC teams. And it's very interesting to look at the composition of DRC teams. Here is the distribution. So when you look at these 14,000 people, researchers working within DRC projects, you can see that 38% are women. That's much higher than most of the statistics. And 62% are men. But we also find, very interestingly, that of course, the gender of the staff working in these teams depends on the fields. On the left, you see life sciences, where you have 52% of women. Then is physical and engineering science, only 23%. And then social science and humanities, 47%. And even more interesting, it shows that the staff distribution depends on the gender of the PI. Women PI tend to hire more women than men PI. So women PI have 47% of researchers working in their teams, while men only have 35%. So we also have a large impact on the research organizations in the European countries. Namely, because we have inspired many of the organizations are modifying their policies because of ERC. For instance, modifying strategies and objectives, funding instruments, forms of administrative organization, and forms of recognition of grantees. Also, some countries are also implementing new funding schemes, copying the ERC model. So funding similar schemes of the ones in ERC, or even sometimes complementing the ERC grants with other extra funds as a recognition of the best way to select, because no country in Europe can make a better selection than the pan-European selection done by the ERC. You have to remember, our applicants come from anywhere in the world. Only on the condition that they will work in Europe. Now also impact, we also are having an impact in gender on the research on ERC through the ERC Scientific Council Gender Equality Plan for 2007-2013. The ERC mission is of course to support excellence frontier research independently of nationality, gender and age, as I've already mentioned to you. Therefore, we have formed early on four working groups, one for international research, relations, one for gender balance, one for relations with industry, and one for open access. And this is the moment to remind you that you have in your bags this flyer, where you have some comments from the ERC, and I would like to call your attention to the fundamental principle stated in our gender balance plan. We firmly believe that women and men are equally able to perform excellent frontier research. Therefore, the ERC Scientific Council plan has three principles: to raise awareness of ERC gender policy among potential applicants in all research fields, to identify and challenge any potential gender bias in the ERC evaluation procedure, and to improve gender balance within the ERC peer review system. So, realizing the Gender Equality Plan 2007-2013, I want to show you this plot where you see that we follow very closely our results, you know, the results of our evaluations, and we try to be aware of any discrimination, any possible discrimination in the system. So here are the statistics for the advanced grants. Only 14% of the applications are from women. So you remember that the advanced grants are for more senior scientists, more senior researchers. And 12% of the grantees are women. So there is a difference here. Of course, the difference also depends on the field. You can see that for the physical engineering sciences, we have only 6% of the grants given and 8% of the applications, while for life science is 14% of grants against 17% of applications. For social science and humanities, the numbers are 21% to 23% of applications. So this is for the more senior grants. For the starting grants, however, the numbers are better. Oh, sorry. The numbers are better for the starting grants. We have 29% of applications by women, but again, 24% of the grants are given to women. And you can see also the distribution by area, by broad area of knowledge. Another thing that I'd also like to share with you is the shares of women in our panels. So women panel members, we have 25 panels, and each one has 12 members. And on the left of each of these groups, you have for the various domains, you will have on the left, the first column on the left is for the panel members. So it's 30% for life science. And then we compare with the number of applications and the number of grants. So the composition of our panel members in life science are very similar to the number of applications. When we go to physical engineering science, we are making a big effort to enlarge the number of panel members. And we have 19% panel members are women. For social science and humanities is 34%. Altogether, we have 27% of women in the panel members, comparing to 25% of applications, and globally, as I mentioned, 20% of grants given. Now we are, because we are already given more than 3,000 grants, it begins to be interesting to look at other parameters, like the geographical distribution by country. You know, all different countries compare, and you have the numbers of the country underneath. I don't dare to repeat the names. I'm sorry, you will see them in the plots when you look at the presentation. But the yellow represent the percentage of women, and the green the percentage of men. And you can see that there are several countries where women are doing much better than the men, a few countries, others where there is a balance, and others where the situation is not so interesting. This is for the advanced grants. Considering all the applications, 2008 to 2011. But the curiosity is that when we move to the starting grants, I always believed that, you know, the younger generations would be more balanced. But surprise, surprise, this is the graph for the starting grants. We have given more than 2,000 starting grants, and you see the situation. It's not so interesting. And even more interesting, in a way, is that those countries where the women were doing much better for the advanced grants, it's not appearing here as an example for the starting grants. So we want to look in detail into these questions. We want to understand, contrary to the previous speaker, we don't know the reasons why we have this systematic difference in a system that we try to control that has to be fair. So prospects for the future. Well, the first thing I wanted to tell you is that we have a rising number of applications. The columns are the colored columns on the left. The first four are for the starting grants, and you can see as the number of applications grows every year. The first years to starting grants 2009, in brown is starting grants 2012. The call is already closed and completely evaluation. And on the right is for the advanced grants. So the number of applications is rising. And you see the small numbers in below, you know, the small histogram in below is the proportional rising of the budget. That is not so steep, unfortunately, as the number of applications. But the good news is the number of applications is rising, so we will have much better information. The other thing we want to know, we have the possibility of launching the so-called coordination and support actions. These are researches that we ask to specialists to do in order to help the scientific council on the decision-making. So we launched one in 2012 on gender aspects in career structures and career paths. And the objective was to map the road to and from excellence and try to understand the patterns and the differences and similarities in the careers for men and for women. And also to look at the DRC applicants and see how they differ from the scientific population and what distinguishes a well-successful applicant from an unsuccessful applicant in DRC. So this study is already started, and there will be a report during 2013, so to help the Scientific Council to make decisions. So in 2013, it's now open another coordination and support action to look at the gender aspects in career ERC proposal submission, peer review, and gender mainstreaming. So the idea is to focus on DRC practices and processes in the context of gender mainstreaming, in particular during the proposal submission and the peer review. The call is open until the middle of January, and there is a reference where if you are interested in applying, you can see all the information. So we are also preparing a workshop during 2013. We will invite representatives for all national research organizations in Europe to discuss the diversity of practices and approaches to gender mainstreaming in the various countries and to exchange best practices and policies aiming at the promotion of wider participation of women. And I'm finishing. Yes, it's my last slide. And we are also preparing a new equality plan for 2014-2020. The preparation will take place during 2013. So thank you for your attention, and you have some addresses for information if you are interested in.
Thank you for this presentation. That was a lot of things that I would like to discuss here, but I will not take all the time. There was one thing you said. I wasn't really sure whether you have evidence for that, or maybe it was slip of the tongue. You said that there were more female collaborators if there was a female PI. That's correct?
Yes.
And then you said the explanation was that the maids don't want to hire females. But I mean, for me, an alternative explanation is that young female scientists are maybe more attracted by having a female PI. Are you sure about this conclusion?
Well, I didn't intend to conclude. Maybe I was not fully understood. This is a sample of more than 600 projects, and we are just looking very objectively at the numbers. And the conclusion is, the numbers show, that if you have a PI, a female PI, the percentage of females in the team is much larger than if you have a male PI. So that's the only conclusion I wanted to take.
Okay, I see. So that was just a mistake. I was very, very worried, actually, about the figures that you showed. In all cases, the success rate for female applicants were lower than what was the application rate.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
And maybe you I don't know if you can understand it for the more elderly researchers, but it's really, let me put it very sort of provocative. This shows that females are not as intelligent as males, obviously, than for young researchers.
Of course not. And because we don't believe in that, we want to understand if there is something slightly wrong in the process. The truth is that there is a difference of, let's say, 2% or 1% in every field, in every domain. Even in domains that are in the community dominated by women, like life science, where you have in research more women in many organizations that you have men, even there, for the life science, there is this difference in success rate. Of course, we exploited more obvious things inside the house, like we looked into statistic in correlations between panel members composition or panel composition and the success rate. We compared with the way the science,
But it could, one of the reports that the previous speaker highlighted was that there is a bias in the system. Maybe this is another example, who knows.
The system has been scrutinized for every bias as we can understand it. That's why we have asked the help of specialists to look into detail, both in the preparation of the CVs, because this is a possibility, the differences in presentation of CVs, we believe, or why we have so few applications, because we don't understand why we only have one-third of the applications by women in the starting grants, where we know that in the community, the women are around 50%. No, but you have to consider something. This is frontier research. It's the very top level of research.
Oh, I understand that.
And it's very
that.
Competitive.
Yes,
so
I understand that too.
Maybe women are reluctant in competing at that level or more conscious or something. We don't dare to conclude.
It's clear. It's one thing that you have fewer female applications. I don't think ERC can do very much about if there are fewer scientists on the market. I think that is more for the maybe the university level, or they are more responsible for that. But if they get the lower success rate, that worries me, actually. But let me leave now the questions to the floor.
But let me just reply to you. We want to have the same proportion of applications as the proportion of scientists in the map. Oh, and that is not happening now. Okay.
Okay, that is a problem. There was a lady there first.
Yes, in fact, I would like to continue on this. And I wonder why you are studying if there is a bias or not. I think that maybe you should admit that there is a bias for whatever reason, and then work on the system to make sure that at the end you have a balanced outcome. Because this is the most important for women. There is no reason that systematically for all topics, women have a lower success rate. So forget about understanding why, just change the system so that you arrive to the right balance. Thank you.
Yeah, but once the system has been checked for the obvious things and you cannot identify, I think it was correct to do what we did, to ask for studies to help us to identify where is the place to make corrections. We are not gender specialists, we are just scientists, you know, in every area.
Okay, there is a second question, and then I think we have to go on. Let's see if we have some more space at the end to ask more questions. But this lady here in the front, yes.
Good afternoon. Catherine Didion from the U.S. National Academies. My comment, which I think is picking up on the conversations you've had before, and we have a colleague here from the U.S. National Science Foundation who can comment on it more, but a review panel or the panel that looks at the applications often becomes a living organism, and they can often influence each other. And so part of what some of the directorates are doing at the National Science Foundation is actually having discussions and training for the panel members as well as the staff about bias, because I think your process, you can have some integrity, but you can actually end up with a result that you don't recognize because of the panel and the process. And the only other thing I would add is, you know, if those numbers of so few women being funded as young researchers, some countries having none, women may be making choices of not applying because they may not be feeling that they can actually do a good job. So I think it's thinking through, particularly for the young researchers, how you can help them maybe with some training so that they can be more viable candidates.
Yes, you're correct. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I'm Marie Water from the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm, Sweden. I must say I've been quite some years now into research, medical research, and I found the figures from the success rate and the applications to the European funding agencies extremely depressing. And I think it's even worse that the figures show, because why should women apply if there's over and over and over again a lower success rate? How can you ask women to apply when it's constantly lower and we know that there is a bias? Another thing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Another thing is that you said it was even better in the panels because you had up to 30% women. It means that you don't give the women research money, but you ask them to come and work for free for the evaluation. And that gives them even less chance.
Can I reply?
Yeah, yes, you have a possibility.
The reply is very short. Of course, if the women do not apply, they will never get a grant. So that's the first reason. Okay, so they have to apply, and we want them to apply. So that's why we try to understand why there is difference between the applications and the success rate. Second, our referees, our panel members are well paid. They do not work for free, because we believe that the scientific work, whatever the field of knowledge, is a very valuable work and must be paid, and is paid. Okay.
Thank you for those comments. Okay, but I will actually move on. I have to keep a little bit to the timetable also. Let's see if we have some more time at the end of this session.